Hello everyone, this is Roostic, and welcome to episode 2 of the Optimal Self Podcast. The goal here is for us to share insights and raise some questions about how to live our best version day to day, how to be more present, and basically how to be more happy. So today on this episode, I'm talking to my friend Frank Velasco. I met him while we were both working on a TV show a couple years ago, and we became good friends. We filmed a couple of videos together, and we decided to have a conversation and record it and see what came out of it. I'm actually really happy with how this podcast turned out. There's a lot of different topics covered, so if you want to actually maybe skip ahead to whatever you're interested in, I'm adding little timestamps in the description so you can do that. And if you're interested in finding out more about the optimal self concept or hear the other podcasts that we have, check out our Facebook page, facebook.com/theoptimalself. Here goes episode 2 of the Optimal Self Podcast. Hope you guys enjoy. Leave us any feedback and let's do this. Hey Frank, so what have you been up to?
Yeah, man, I'm glad you asked. I have been basically kind of realizing that there's a lot of talking that I do mm-hmm. about stuff that I want to do, and people are involved too. People are excited about it and they want to do it, and they're talking with me and the excitement level's there. And then the action is just not happening at the rate that it feels like yeah. would be matching that excitement level.
Yeah.
So, in existing only in the now, mm-hmm. if anything can happen now, there's never a, oh, I'm going to call him tomorrow, or oh, I'm going to do this tomorrow. It's like, no. Right. Text him now. Call yeah. him now. Do the filming now if you can.
Yeah.
There's nothing you should ever put off toward the future. And so,
right.
there's a lot of kind of eye openings that I've been doing in terms of like, well, I keep making this plan to do this thing. Why is that a plan? Why is it not just happening?
Yeah. It's funny you said that. Like, I've actually been kind of going through the same thing recently. I started reading this book called The 4-Hour Workweek. It's over there.
I saw that.
If you want. Have you read it?
I've been planning to read it for a while.
Yeah, it's awesome. I have the same problem because I spent so much time meditating and studying and journaling and stuff, and then I started listening to a couple of podcasts, and I luckily stumbled on Tony Robbins and listened to a podcast with him.
Yeah.
And he was saying, like, it's just, what did he say? He said, knowledge without action is, like, useless. You know?
That's right.
Action is always going to win over just knowledge, you know? So, like, you're talking about doing stuff and being present. The way I see that in my world when you start talking about it is I relate that to time management. So, the past week or two for me, my mantra has just been, like, time management, you know? Like, I feel like I'm wasting a lot of time by just only doing things when I feel passionate to do them in the moment, you know?
That's right.
At the same time, what I'm trying to say is action precedes motivation, you know? So have you ever heard of that concept? Like, motivation is a function of action. So you start doing something. And then, like, today, like, you just start doing it. You just say, like, we just met up. You just hit me up out of nowhere. I was right. longboarding around town, and I was like, yes. I just said yes. Let's do this. Let's meet up. Let's film something or do something.
Right.
So that's, like, action. And now that we're here, it's, like, motivation. It's, like, you know. That's
interesting. Yeah. As, like, I mean, almost much begets more. Like, when you put off doing it, then it's just more of nothing. But as you take the action brings in the motivation. You feel the confidence in doing the thing, and it makes you want to do more of the thing.
Yeah, it's like a positive feedback loop
exactly.
versus a negative feedback loop. Because the exact opposite of that is, oh, I'm not doing anything today. I feel like crap. I don't feel like doing anything today, but I feel like crap. It's like keep going. You know?
That's right.
Or like you start doing something, and you feel better because you already did something, and you realize you might as well do something else, and you continue.
Totally, totally. I mean, I think that's one of the harder parts in knowing yourself and achieving what your goals are is like recognizing. Sure, it's important to go with the flow, but you can't just, like, wait until you're feeling like you're ready to do this.
Yeah.
Or like, oh, good, like, this is the first day I've woken up and I'm super inspired in a week, so I'm going to go out and film something only today. Like,
yeah.
that's not how it works. You're going to be creating that pattern. You're going to be stuck in that cycle of, oh, I'm not feeling anything. I'll sleep a little longer. Like,
right.
You know.
And I think that also ties into something that I've been trying to do the past week or two is having a morning routine.
Mm.
One thing I learned from listening, especially to Tim Ferriss's podcast, I would recommend it if you get a chance. And he talks to a lot of very successful people or mindful people. Like,
he gets, because of him being an author that's written 3 books, he has some pull and he's able to get in touch with people at the tops of their fields. And on his podcast, he basically interviews them. It's still like a conversation, but he asks them and he breaks them down, kind of like the 4-hour work week concept of like 80-20 analysis of people. Like, what is the 20% of stuff that you do that gives you 80% of your results? And he asks these people all the time. And the most consistent thing that I've found, he always asks everybody the same question, and that is, what does the first 60 minutes of your day look like? And the people that are very successful, that the podcast that I enjoy the most, they always come back with an answer like an actual answer of their structure for the first 60 minutes of their day, because that seems to be the most important from what I've observed.
And is that like their... Are they making a plan for the rest of the day in the 60 minutes? Or do you think there's some meditational manifestation? Or do you think they're just like... I mean, I've heard, you know, a lot of successful people say you should always have your day planned ahead of time. Mm-hmm. So are they waking up and getting into their day, or are they just carrying out a plan for maybe from the day before?
Well, I mean, from just what I've observed, from what I've listened to, there's different people. Like, mm-hmm. sometimes you'll talk to an artist, and sometimes you'll talk to a real business person, and they'll have slightly different styles. Like, some people will plan their day the night before, and they'll get up and they'll have a plan ready to go. Some people will wake up, these are more like artistic people, they'll plan their day in those first 60 minutes. But the most consistent thing that I've noticed is everybody across the board has some sort of stillness or meditation practice or insight practice, every person. What I've been incorporating in my days for the past month or so, and I fall off here and there, but then I get back on, and that is, this is what my morning routine looks like, is I wake up, brush my teeth, and meditate for 10 minutes. I tell myself just 10 minutes, you know, sometimes I'll go over, sometimes I'll do less, but it's just that, like, not passive meditation either, it's just like literally like super conscious, present meditation. And then I'll journal. So then I'll free write for like 5 or 10 minutes.
Nice.
And then, you know, my day gets started. Ideally, I want to add in some exercise before that, because these successful people, one of my favorite podcasts with Tim Ferriss, mm-hmm. is he talks to his friend Josh Waitzkin, who's like a chess prodigy, and he wrote a book called The Art of Learning, and he's very successful in different fields, and he advises like top business people now and stuff, and strategies. And what he says is, before you go to bed, you ask yourself, what is the most important question in what I'm doing right now? So, you know, you figure out what that question is and what you need to do, and what's your most important problem that you need to solve. And you just, like, clear your mind, you think about that. You don't give yourself an answer. You just really think about the different solutions and you go to bed. And in the morning, he says he'll meditate and then he'll free write on that. And he'll just free write the answer. Even if he doesn't know what's going to come out of it, he just free writes like a paragraph or two.
Right. pen to paper. There's a word for that, like conscious stream of thought or something.
Right.
Yeah.
And I haven't been doing that every morning, but I did it for like 3 days in a row about a week ago.
Nice.
And it's made my life go from like a big field of possibilities, which it still is, but it's made my focus kind of start narrowing. And it gave me, and it started building that motivation again back up. So for example, one morning, the very first time I wrote it, in the morning I wrote down, which direction should I go? Because I have several different projects. You know, I have my stunt career, I have my YouTube channel, I have a couple of business ideas that I'm working on, like for the festival scene. And I was like, what am I going to do? What am I supposed to do? Because I realized I can't do everything at once. And, you know, I sat down and I was confused. I just started writing. I wrote down, what should I focus on primarily? And then I just started free writing. And I have the page in my diary still. When I go through it, it's like halfway through, I still don't know what I'm doing. And then I just started like breaking down each of the things that I have on my plate. And then I started realizing what's going to add the most value. This is another thing that Tony Robbins and a lot of successful people talk about, is measure your days by how much value you added. You know, whatever that means, like to yourself or to others, like if you actually added value to your life and to others' lives in that day, then that's a successful day. So I started analyzing. I still don't know the clear answer, but that day I realized that I should focus more on creating value. So that's what made me realize, even though like I didn't have a clear answer in between the 3 things that I'm going for right now. Just adding value and
general value to the world. I feel like when you're saying that, you're not just saying, obviously we all want to add value to ourselves. We want to make money. We want to have a career changing opportunity happen in one day, which things usually don't happen overnight. They're gradual, but we want to have a day that's extremely valuable. But I feel like, and correct me if I'm wrong, I'm kind of asking in a statement form, you're talking about adding value to people's lives, like sharing things that have helped you help lift everyone up.
Yeah, I think that's what the way I'm going about doing it right now. Yeah, adding value to people,
which is why we're here.
Yes,
because I am very strong and passionate about adding value to people, and I don't think it's that hard. I think it's simple concepts that make a huge difference in people's lives. You know, it's not like usually it's not like they're homeless and they're doing like, and they need to like do all these things and it's going to change everything. Usually it's like they're close to success. They're passionate and they want to get there. They're on the path, but they just can't figure it out. There's something that they're missing either in the morning routine or time management. Mm-hmm. You know, it's usually not like a night and day shift. Sometimes it is.
Yeah.
But like oftentimes, oh, what was it? I heard this really great quote. I'm forgetting the author now. So if someone out there is listening and knows, then post it. There was an author that was talking about this study that was done on what makes people beautiful. And they like mathematically analyzed a bunch of people's faces. And sometimes it came down to a millimeter difference of like a mole being in a different place or like your nose being slightly lopsided or you know, different physical characteristics that two people look very similar, but this person would be considered classically beautiful or good looking and this person wouldn't. And it's that millimeter difference. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what I'm talking about, is sometimes all it takes is that millimeter shift in your thinking to be able to realize those goals that you are passionate about, that you're thinking about all day, but for some reason there's just something blocking you that...
Yeah,
I think, you know, it doesn't have to be this huge earth-shattering thing.
I totally agree with you. I think... I heard the same concept of the study that you're talking about on a Tim Ferriss podcast with Tony Robbins.
Oh, cool.
That he did. I can share it with you. I'll put it in the show notes. But you're right. The very small changes is what makes someone either successful in the moment or not successful in the moment. And that's what has long-term implications for the future. I have this book I'm reading right now called The Slight Edge. By Jeff Olson. Have you read it?
I friggin' love The Slight Edge, and I've met Jeff Olson. I actually used to work with him.
You met him?
Worked with him, not very closely,
right.
But I worked in a company with him, and I got to, on a like bi-weekly basis, actually talk with him.
Nice. What was he like?
Really cool. He's down to earth. Sometimes he will be not dealing with people's bullshit, so I've seen people get a little hurt sometimes because he just is like, no nonsense, you know, he's just right. But he's really straight with people, and he's, you know, pretty good, pretty cool guy. Very good businessman.
Nice. Yeah, just, so the Slight Edge is about, the Slight Edge book is about the concept of how your whole life isn't a drama type story that we're used to seeing on TV growing up and stuff. This is at least how I took the book, and it's just a combination of very, very small decisions that you always can make. That are easy to make and easy not to make.
Yes.
You know, and it's that slight edge, the concept of it is like, if as long as you just have that extra little bit of awareness at the time when you're making these little decisions, like one of the examples in the book, I think, was you could go to a restaurant and it's easy to order a salad and it's just as easy to order a burger or something if you're trying to like decide between those types of eating. Or it's very easy to do 10 push-ups in the morning and it's very easy not to do 10 push-ups in the morning. And these types of like small decisions like add up over time exponentially. So, you know, for the first like 30 days or whatever, you don't really see much difference. But as long as you stay on that path, eventually you speed up, and what seems to others outside of you as like this crazy breakthrough that we're all used to, like the media likes to sensationalize. Oh my God, this person went from zero to like a millionaire in like 3 weeks and he did it by doing this. Like, no, that's bullshit. Like that person's put in thousands of hours of work, or however many hours, maybe not thousands, but that it's always like a combination of factors that people don't see that gives you your own success. It's the stuff that it's like you do on your own time, that how you spend your time with yourself, what little habits of thinking, what little habits of doing you give yourself that adds up.
Absolutely. I think it does. Yeah, it comes down a lot to like knowing yourself too, asking questions, being honest with yourself, because it is those little things, you know. I talk to people all the time and they're like, they're complaining about something and they're saying like, oh, well, I don't know what I'm going to do in this situation, but they have already expressed what they want. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like an issue of not knowing yourself or not being confident in your decisions. If you know that if every time you're faced with like, this is a funny example, but it's just the first thing that comes to mind. Let's say someone is thinking about like being dishonest in a relationship, you know, and they don't know what to do. And every time they're faced with the opportunity to go outside that relationship, they do. But then they're wondering why they have an unhappy relationship.
Right.
Well, that's why, because you're saying you want to have a happy relationship, but you're not making the choices that you know will bring about that.
Right.
And it is that slight edge. I mean, that's a funny example because it's a little more obvious than I think some examples and situations are in people's lives. You know, they may think, well, why am I not losing weight? But then they go and they order that burger every single time. Mm-hmm. Or they're not exercising at all.
It's like, it applies to bad decisions. Like, just as like good decisions. Like, if you, like, that person, like, for that hypothetical person that orders a burger every single time or eats, like, a bag of Doritos, you know, that one bag of Doritos is not going to do anything to you. Just like if you exercise all the time, you eat one bag of Doritos, you're fine. Like, it's not going to do anything. But it's the unconscious choices that people make that are bad that really add up over time, you know. So somebody will think, oh, it's just one bag of Doritos. Then the next day they forget. They're like, oh, it's just one bag of Doritos. Every single day for like a year, just one bag of Doritos adds up. You know, you had 365 bags of Doritos. Or like in the Slight Edge book, he talks about if you give yourself like an assignment, I'm going to read 10 pages of a good book today. You know, just 10 pages or like a self-improvement book, you know, once a day. In a year's time, you read over 3,000 pages. That's like 10 really wonderful books that are probably going to add to your way of thinking, your lifestyle and everything.
That's right. Yeah, that will help guide you, like,
yeah.
And they can give you some direction. I mean, I think I know that I'm guilty too, even as you're saying it, I'm realizing.
Oh, me too. I'm not more. Perfect.
Yeah, no.
We're talking about a concept here, but it's like, I'm not like... I'm just talking about this and like not implementing it. No way.
Yeah. But like, I think a lot of my stubbornness and refusal to read more is a lot of my ego too. I think my ego tends to think, oh, mm-hmm. I'm smart. I can do this on my own. I don't need help. And it's not like you're not doing it on your own when you're reading these books and you're getting these incredible pieces of wisdom that can help you. You still have to go out and do it. There's not going to be like, yeah. Oh, now I have, again, this magical piece thing. Now suddenly everything's going to click and it's going to be perfect from here on in because I read this. Like,
right.
No.
It's not like that.
No. Yeah.
It's that. That's good. That's thinking like your life is some sort of, I mean, it is like that, but it's not. Like, the actual decision is very small and it's not a big step you gotta take. I think it's just like just being slightly more aware and then just like waiting, just it's like that slightly, it's like listening just a little bit more to what you really want right now, you know. That's like goes back to the concept of like if you're fully present, then you're always going to make the best choice for yourself in the future. Your future self's going to thank you for it. If you're unconscious in the present moment, you're doing habit, and that habit could be a good one or a bad one, you know. But unfortunately, most of the time, our unconscious habits are not really good, you know, unless you take the time to really build up those, you know, it's always better to be conscious.
Yeah.
You know, so when you're like enjoying a conversation with someone or when you're like sitting with your loved one, you're not unconsciously like blasting through it and then forgetting about it. You're like here, and then you can always make those little, you can add on to the moment all the time versus like not adding anything or unconsciously reacting to something negatively and then being like, why did I react like that later, you know?
Right. Yeah. I mean, if you can, I think that's even better than a lot of people do. I think many people don't even look at it later. Mm. You know, I've known people that will just react a certain way and then later get into victim mentality and they're not even thinking like, oh, they're not even aware that they contributed to it. They're just like, that was done to me.
Yes.
And that's so disempowering. Like, if anything, you need to take control of it. You need to recognize, I'm the common denominator in this. I am a person with free will. I can choose what I want. Why did I not choose the thing that would bring me that? Now, obviously, also there's some randomness too. You can't, not to make excuses for anyone, but there are times when you are victim to something.
Right.
But for the most part, like most things that happen to you, you play some part, you have some control over, and it's better. It gives you the confidence and it's empowering to recognize you can do something rather than just not even look at it or blame it on something else.
I think what you said about victim mentality is, especially right now, I'm actually helping a really close friend of mine through a tough time.
Oh.
And it's very frustrating watching this person. Like, a bunch of bad stuff's going on, right, in his life. And that, I've seen it grow. I've seen it add on to itself and accumulate, you know. And I've seen it just, like, not now he's in a bad place in his life, but it's not just all of a sudden this happened to him. It's just added up over time. But this person, I'm trying to make him turn his gaze inwards, you know, but it's really hard because every single thought that comes out is automatically external. It's like, this happened to me. Why did this happen? And they're like, well, because this, something else happened to me. I'm like, but why did that happen? Because this other thing happened to me. You know, as I've noticed in my life that as soon as I start putting like my, you know, if I'm always reacting, I'm always playing catch up to like my life, right? But like if I just like drop it, everything, and just like focus inward and breathe, and then realize that if you take radical responsibility for everything that happened to you, even when you said sometimes you're a victim, right, you still take responsibility for that completely, fully, no matter what. That's like the thought path, the through line that has been working for me is just take responsibility for absolutely every single thing, and then you have all the power, because then you choose how you react to it and you can build something versus always like trying to avoid the negatives, always looking outside of yourself and then being like, okay, that thing sucks, I'll fix that thing. Okay, what sucks next? Oh, that thing sucks, I'll fix that thing. Rather than looking inside and be like, okay, what's good? Okay, I'm going to build on this like good thing, you know?
Right. I mean, you're always going to be like trying to treat the symptoms rather than the disease if you're going that way.
Yeah, exactly.
The inner world is a reflection of the outer world. So when things are going wrong, sure, you can be
going
around.
Or the outer world is a reflection of the inner world.
Both ways, yeah. they're absolutely right. They both affect each other, and they're both mirrors of each other, which is the crazy thing. There's no real separation, even though we feel this sort of conscious separation. Like, obviously, there's space in this room, there's physical things we can touch, and then there's thoughts that are going on in our brains that are different than the physical reality. And that goes with what you were saying about the second you say it, it becomes this external thing. Mm-hmm. But really, there's such a strong connection before you even say it that it's physically, I feel, I mean, you know, some might debate, but I feel like our thoughts are physically shaping the world around us. So it can be more tempting, I feel like, to take the easier route and just fix the physical things, because we can move our hands and we can do these things, and a lot of the internal questions are hard for people to deal with. Mm-hmm. But if you can go look inward and really examine, you know, like, okay, this thing happened because I was needing some drama that day, you know? I've had days when I walked out of the house not feeling great, and I got into a fight with someone, and I knew in my head that I attracted that person.
Right.
Because I was vibing on that same energy. It wasn't even like anything bad happened physically in the real world. There was just something that our vibrations matched, and that negativity was going to pull towards each other. Mm-hmm. And that is what the hard thing. I've dealt with friends like that too, as you're talking with this friend, to try and not blame himself. Because I've also seen people do that, where they're like, oh, it's all my fault. And then it's not the correct kind of inward.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah.
You know, it's almost like victim to myself or something, you know, like some weird kind of loop thing. Yeah. But to really look inward and be like, okay, if I wasn't stressed about this job, then I wouldn't be coming home and beating my dog, you know, or I wouldn't be like starting this fight with someone over a parking space just because I'm so tense. Like,
it's a scary thing for a lot of people to do is like look inside, but then look inside with no judgment. You know, just this is what it is. And it's scary, but then, like, you know, obviously I'm not saying I'm perfect. I still fall into reactive habits and patterns. But, like, once I am able to break through, like, once you get through, it's like you realize there's nothing scary. There is no like bad or good or like thing in there. It's just, it is what it is, right? And this is when people talk about like living out of like love or fear. Like, if you're afraid of something the whole time, you're constantly reacting. Fear is a reaction to something, right?
That's right.
And like love, like if you want to talk about love or like in a general sense, like all the good feelings, most of the good feeling, the honesty and love comes from like, there's no reaction. It's because you're so present and grounded that it's just coming from the inside out, right?
Right.
Like, love comes from the inside out. If you think about it, fear does not come from the inside out. I've met people that have talked about before, like a while ago, I've met people that would tell me that, oh, you can, you know, when we talk about like flotation tanks and stuff, people would be like, I'm so, you know, I can't go in there. I have too many demons and I'm just scared of myself. And they'd be like kind of proud to say that. And I'm just like, you know, that's kind of like the ego talking. And I'm just like, well, right, what do you mean you have demons? Like, that means you need to like look inside even more, like, and realize like if you really work through that stuff, then like the true center, like there is no demons. It's just like calmness, you know?
That's right. Yeah. I mean,
I've only gone there like once or twice, but I'm trying to like do that every day of my life. But I've been there, like when I went to the meditation retreat for a couple of weeks afterwards, I was just very fortunate to find that stillness inside. And it was just like, it wasn't even just nothing. Like, you would think that, some people would think that the stillness means just there's nothing.
Right.
But what would happen is I would get random bursts of laughter and random bursts of happiness and just smiling at once I was calm and like once I was in the center, you know? So that's like, so if you want to talk about whatever you want to call it, like whether it's your actual neurology and neuroscience, whether it's the cosmos, whether it's collective consciousness, like whatever is in there, the very, very basic element of it is just like, just spontaneous bursts of happiness, you know? It's crazy.
It is. It's true. A real quick side question, then I'll continue just for everyone listening and for me too. Was that the Pasama Honda? What is that?
Yeah, the Vipassana.
Vipassana,
10-day retreat.
Yeah, which is funny because I've been really wanting to go on that. And one of my good friends that I've known for like 9 years that I met in show business doing background, he went on that a couple of times. And I thought he came back very spiritual. And lately, he's actually someone that I feel like has been in the wrong spiritual paradigm. He's been like I was riding with the car on him yesterday, and he's normally a very peaceful spiritual guy, and he's cursing at every person that cuts us off, and he's like being very hostile towards people he doesn't even know. And then he's like, why aren't you joining with me to say, yeah, fuck that guy? And I'm like, well, I'm just being present, dude. I don't know him. I don't need to say fuck him. He's like, but you're my friend, so join with me. And it's like, you know, people want, they don't want to feel alone. But I've also heard, you know, to get back to that stillness, that people that are not present can be annoyed by other people with presence. You know, they feel like fearful. The ego, I think, gets afraid that like it's going to be exposed or killed as or it's death, as some people refer to.
Right.
I know we've talked about a couple other authors, but whenever I get into the subject, I always think of like Eckhart, Eckhart Tolle. I don't know how much if you've read or listened to of him.
I've read part of The Power of Now.
Okay.
I read it right after the retreat.
Oh, nice.
The meditation retreat.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, when I was reading that book, I was like, okay, he's using slightly different language than I would use.
Right.
But this book itself is exactly what I just learned. I'm like, this is awesome. Like the way he talks about like the pain body and but what I wouldn't say the pain body. I would just say like the physical body, the sensational body, that's like your subconscious and your mind. Sorry, and your body,
your meat, the meat versus whatever that place that those spontaneous bursts of happiness and joy were coming from after the retreat. They weren't coming from your physical body. They were coming from, I mean, maybe there was some connection because yes, you're alive and your soul and your body are connected.
Right.
But I still feel like when you talk about that love versus fear, that stillness, being is love. The fact that we're alive, mm-hmm. that we're here, whatever the meaning of life is, whatever, we don't know why we're here, but we do exist. No one can argue that. The fact that we exist and we breathe, that stillness is what I feel where our joy mm-hmm. emanates from. You know, just the sheer fact of being alive is a good thing. And I think that's the thing I like about Eckhart, too, is not to make anyone shy away by saying this, because I know it's a four-letter word these days, but God, mm-hmm. not used in any religious terms, because right. I'm not that religious. I actually didn't even believe in God for a good portion of my life, and I've kind of circled back around. I don't know if you knew that. And I don't think that God can be explained in any normal way. When I say God, I mean the universe. Yeah. I mean
the great mystery.
The great mystery. Yeah. It's not a being.
Yeah. It's not some guy with a beard on the cloud. Right. It's not like some crazy, like, in my definition of it, like you said, I just don't use that term too much, but I don't shy away from it anymore either. It's just kind of like, I try and use it more as like to express the concept of like the mystery. Like there's something that we don't know, something that connects us, and that like that spontaneous love that comes out, like at the very like base level, like, you know, and when people talk about like, nirvana and like how it's all on the inside of you, you know, it's
yes.
it's not like it's very easy, I think, for people to run away with dogma and create little like this is like the whole we're talking about like, the process of being unconscious. And unconsciousness breeds like reactivity, and you're reacting to things which breeds these like structures of thinking, which breeds like little habits that you think that, you know, I feel like that's where dogma comes from, like sectarianism, right? Like that's what I liked about that retreat is it's non-sectarian. Like, so they're literally like, just breathe and just pay attention, and there's nothing else. And then
wow.
I got so much wisdom just from doing that. And then they start explaining, like, if you think back to like all these major religions, it always starts with a divine experience that someone had, right? And then if let's use Jesus as an example, or, you know, the Buddha, for example, Jesus, right? Honestly, if you go back in time, you'd probably be like, oh, he's a bro. He's just like us. He's a really cool guy. He's not like telling people they can't have sex before marriage. He's not saying all this random stuff. He's not telling you to say three Hail Marys after you go to church. He's not telling you to, like, you know, do all this stuff. He's just like, guys, chill out. Like, he came about when like the Jews were being very, very sectarian and strict, and his whole thing was like, dude, calm down, it's all on the inside, breathe, you know. Same with the Buddha, like the first one, there's been many. Buddha's right. just the term for an enlightened person, but right. like the first one, he, you know, he grew up as like a prince, and he was super like rich and had all these things given to him. And then one day he realized, oh, he saw like suffering, which his father was trying to hide him from. He just saw like a sick man. He was like, what's happening here? And he went out into the world and just started just really, once again, non-sectarianism. There was no other gods involved. He was just like breathing and listening. And what he reached his enlightenment, he taught that method to other people. And it was called Vipassana, which is actually cool about the retreats. That's the same technique that he used to reach enlightenment. Oh, but wow. like his whole thing is, it's non-sectarian. It's literally just paying attention and being so present, and also consciously, once you find that love, just consciously growing and building on it and being constructive, you know. And it's, everything else just stems from that. But the concept is, everybody's concept is simple, you know. It's like, there was one person in these religions that had a good thing. They try and teach people, and then over time things get diluted and people misunderstand, people use it for their own power. This is the unfortunate thing about religion. It's power, and it becomes this like ugly thing, you know. But if you think about it, right back to everybody, they had the same thing. They had the same concepts. It's like, do good things, avoid doing bad things, and purify your mind. This one is what's very interesting to me, segueing into how prayer relates to meditation.
Ooh.
Because when we're at the retreat, for example, it's a silent retreat. You wake up at 4 a.m., you go meditate like 11 hours a day, and they feed you really like healthy food. You drink a lot of water, you go to bed. It reminded me of a monastery, because I grew up, my parents were very religious, and it reminds me of a monastery. It was just like a guy walks around with like a gong, you wake up, you go meditate, you have the schedule, and you, when you go to the meditation hall, there was no images, there was nothing on the walls. It was just like a room. It was like nicely, you had like a place to sit and close your eyes, and but it's had this like overtone of like, wow, this is kind of like a church and or a monastery, but has no religions associated with it. And then I kind of realized, well, meditation is like what prayer is trying to do, but you're actually don't have any sectarianism and you're only trying to be present, right? So, and also one of the ways I describe meditation at the retreat was you can use different tools to sharpen your mind, to make your concentration very present. And there's different tools. You can use the breath, which is what they taught there, because it's the most like nothing attached to it. It's just non-sectarian. You can use an image. You can focus on an image of a Buddha or of a cross. Oh. And you can use incantations, or what did you call them? Like when people say Om, or if people like you say a prayer over and over and over and over. When you say certain words over and over and over and over, eventually this is like neuroscience back to this, like your mind disassociates the meaning of those words, but you just have the word, and then that makes your mind also get razor sharp focus, right? Okay. So it's like those different, they're just different tools for people, like for people that pray in the morning and evening religiously. You know, if you take away the sectarianism, they're waking up and they're consciously focusing their mind for about 10 minutes on what they want to achieve that day, on their family, you know, however they use, whatever words they use, on themselves, and then they go about their day. And in the evening, they clear their mind again, they think about the day that went by, they think about what they want to do next, right? But then there's all these like sectarian stuff involved, but that's why like meditation is like, and before I would be shying away from it, I'd be like, no, throw the baby out with the bathwater. But now I'm like, well, just throw out like the sectarianism and you can actually use these things as tools just for you to give yourself a direction and go somewhere, you know.
And to connect to that inner strength, whether right. you call it the universe or God or existence or essence or, yeah. or life. I mean, there's a bunch of different names for it. And the truth is none of those names are true and do it justice. They're just words that are placeholders for the thing.
Yes.
But yes. whatever you can do to connect to source, that's one of my favorite words, because mm-hmm. it's where that, you know, like we were saying, that it's the origination point. It's the source of life energy, your excitement, your, you know, all of your feelings come from that place within, and you have to be connected. If you're not connecting to it, like, what's the point? Yeah. Why, you know, what are you doing?
I was listening to a podcast yesterday with Joe Rogan and nice. Alex Gray and Allison Gray. They're two artists, they're visionary artists. They do a lot of like psychedelic art, and they're actually building a really cool non-sectarian like place where you can go and just study the psychedelic phenomenon. It's wow. called the Entheon in New York. But they were just talking about religion yesterday, and they were saying how the word religion is, it's either Latin, it's kind of from Latin or French or whatever, it's religio, and it just means to reconnect. So at the basis, before you add all this other bullshit of people and whatever, it's just to reconnect to the source. Somewhere, something people can use as a tool to reconnect to themselves, like you're saying. So that's funny that you said that. And I wanted to mention, because you also said people attach themselves to words versus the meaning behind the words. There's another really good podcast I was listening to with Joe Rogan, Duncan Trussell, and I think it's Christopher Ryan. I'll put the link in the description too.
Okay.
I'll send it to you. But they were also had a really cool conversation where they were talking about people get hung up on words than the meaning behind the words. You know, and that's kind of very similar to people getting caught up in dogma versus what's the point behind it. Like, what are you trying to achieve? You know, and I think, unfortunately, especially like with lately, like if everybody wants to talk, I talk about 2015 being as the year of like, everybody's like reacting to something, everybody has some sort of cause, and everybody's being offended by everything. But like, if you're being offended by something, you're reacting to somebody's words, which means that, you know, it's just, I don't know what I'm going to
say. You're not seeing past them. I mean, I'm guilty of it too. Even as I talk about it, I'm talking about it to explore it deeper so that I can understand yeah. myself better. I'm not saying that I understand it or that I have all the answers, yeah. but I do hear myself listening to someone talk, and I get stuck on the words sometimes. Yeah. And I think I'm, you know, without trying to stroke my own ego, I think that I'm pretty good at seeing past words, and I still all the time see myself like, why did I argue with that person over what was meant or what was said, when words only go so far? You can't you can never even really know what someone else is talking about. So we can't get hung up on the words. We need to be so about clarity and truth and spiritual evolution that we're not taking harm if someone says mean words to us, and we're not taking harm if someone doesn't understand our words.
Yeah.
Because they're just that. They're words, and people come from so many different backgrounds that you have to... And I'm speaking slowly because I'm thinking of times in my life. We all need to be more compassionate and not get stuck on just the individual things that we say that sometimes do activate our pain bodies or whatever, you know.
And be impeccable with our word. That's what I've been trying to do with this podcast and with these videos. Is I actually just got this book about public speaking recently, and I'm realizing how important it is to be able to communicate your thoughts clearly and in the way exactly that you want them to be understood, so there's no chance that somebody would misunderstand them, you know?
It's hard.
And it is hard, but it is possible, you know?
Absolutely.
And have you heard, there's these four...
The four agreements?
The four agreements. Have you heard
of it? Don Miguel Ruiz. Yeah.
One of them is be impeccable with your word. That's awesome. I don't remember the other ones because I just...
I know them all. And there's actually a fifth agreement.
Where are these agreements from?
They're Toltec. They're Toltec wisdom. He's a Toltec Indian.
Okay.
And they're ancient wisdoms that he was taught by his grandfather, who was taught by his grandfather, that are passed way down. And it's spiritual teachings that they used to propagate through the Toltec culture.
Okay.
And they're very spiritual. They're, you know, we might... I like it because it's... Even though there is probably a certain amount of... what'd you say? Secretarianism.
Sectarianism.
There's a certain amount of structure and all that.
Yeah.
It's outside of what most people are going to have experienced in religion before. So it helps to kind of not have what our meanings attached to the words, and we can see it a little bit more clearly.
Right.
But the four agreements are be impeccable with your word, I think, is the first one. Mm-hmm. Always do your best. And he says your best will be different every day, so you can't blame yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, if, as long as you're trying your hardest, that's all you can do. there is... Oh, shoot. Am I going to be able to remember them? Of course, because we're on the spot. I probably won't. Be impeccable with your word. Always do your best. They're right on the tip of my brain. Yeah, just look them up, because I know...
I'm going to find them right now.
There it is. Exactly.
So be impeccable with your word, speak with integrity, say only what you mean, avoid using the word to speak against yourself or to gossip about others, use the power of your word in the direction of truth and love. Actually, I'm just going to go back and I'm just going to read the four ones, and then we could talk about them one by one.
Perfect.
So the four agreements that you were just talking about are... Actually, do you want to say them?
Whatever. Okay. I mean,
so the four agreements that we're talking about on this website, ToltecSpirit.com, is be impeccable with your word. Don't take anything personally. Don't make assumptions. And always do your best.
There it is.
So, right away, when I'm looking at this, I think that being... When I was reading through these, so don't take anything personally and don't make assumptions, I think they're kind of related in the sense that, like, if you take something personally, you're making the assumption that they're talking about you. And if you make assumptions, you're basically unconscious, you know?
Right.
I feel like each one of these points, be impeccable with your word, don't take anything personally, don't make assumptions, and always do your best, each one of them puts you into like a conscious mindset, I think.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. It's not really like an easy... They're not really placeholders.
Yeah.
That when you think about the concepts, they're concepts that do force you to think. It's not like you can just rely on them. It's not just something you can...
Yeah.
Say, oh, that's what it is, and now I have it figured out.
Yeah.
They're states of being, so it forces you to kind of...
They can only be applied in the present moment.
Very right. Well said. Exactly. Yeah, that's right. And there is some overlap. I'm glad you said that, because I was, even as we were reading them, I was feeling like there's some overlap. And then there's some very careful distinctions, too. Like, when you were talking about really thinking about someone, about getting your message across clearly. I think don't make assumptions means don't assume anyone's ever going to understand you. Mm-hmm. Don't use shorthand. I mean, and don't use shorthand goes along with be impeccable with your word.
Right.
But how often do... I mean, I'm answering my own question. How often do I hear myself a lot taking shortcuts even with, like, say, a curse word. Like, if I'm using, you know, I'll say, oh, well, this shit, and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And that's not being impeccable.
That's,
yeah,
like,
you're
a shortcut
angry.
Of thinking.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And you're only shorting yourself.
Right.
There's no, it's not like, oh, I'm saving time. Like, well, no, your brain is not being accurate. So you're not giving the universe something that it can use.
You're not being your full, you're not being fully present, and, like, you're not using the full potential of your brain. If you want to swear about something, you can use very precise language to describe it, because then somebody else will be like, oh, you're right, this is exactly how I understand how you feel, versus, like, what is this shit, what's the blah 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 blah. And then, like, I mean, not that we should be, like, spreading negativity in general, but I guess that, like, if we're conscious in the first place, and then we realize it's not worth it for me to explain this, how negative I feel about this person in the first place, because it'll take too many words, then I just won't do it, versus taking the shortcut and be like, oh, whatever, and swearing at somebody, or flipping the middle finger when you're driving, or, like, you know.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, it sounds like we're about to be like, you, sir, have cut me off in your carriage.
Your horse cut me off.
Yeah.
Oh, man. No, yeah, it's true. I absolutely am trying to think more clearly about the audience, because you're always going to know what you're saying.
Right.
Will the other person, will the ideas take seed and spread, and, you know,
yeah,
will you grow? Or is it, because, you know, you can try and teach someone all day long a million great, amazing things. You can be in front of Mensa scholars, mm-hmm, and the most brilliant people in the world, and if they don't have any frame of reference, if they can't understand it, it's just wasted time. It's like there's no transfer of knowledge, or... Yeah.
That's why I think it's like we're talking about language sometimes being a little bit of a barrier to... It's just a tool, right? It's just
totally
a tool. Language is a tool that we could use to make each other think of something, and then in effect after that feel something, right? So whatever I'm feeling right now, I'm trying to transfer to you just by the free flow of words that's going on through my head right now. I just have a quick question. Have you ever noticed that whenever you talk to someone for long enough and you get to, like, the basic, like, this usually happens after a night of drinking or smoking weed or something.
Okay.
And, like, I've had this conversation with people where I'm, like, talking, and we're talking, and I'm trying to, like, really understand this person, and they're trying to really understand me, but, like, we seem to be disagreeing until we get to the very, very basic problem, and that was, there was, like, one word that was being used slightly differently, you know? Have you ever had that happen to you?
I have. Yeah. That's one of the most fascinating things in life to me about, like, I'm very fascinated by people in general, but the psychology of, like, how we interact, and, again, what we're communicating towards each other is so interesting. I mean, I think, I don't know about your friend that is kind of spiraling down a path, but, like, my friend, I know... very often he's saying something that I just can't agree with. Mm-hmm. And I feel like because English is also his second language, he learned Spanish first, that sometimes he's saying words that aren't really what he's thinking. Mm-hmm. And so he's defending his thoughts, but he's not realizing, well, your words didn't express that. Mm-hmm. But then I'm also being guilty of picking on, oh, well, this word, instead of trying to infer what he did mean. Mm-hmm. So there is that whole kind of dance of, like,
yeah. And I think even between people that whose language is their first language, I sometimes find that, like, I mean, English wasn't my first language, but I found that I could speak English as it was my first language now.
Right.
But I found that, like, even between two completely English-speaking people that grew up in the same exact place, that, like, they could have just a slightly different meaning for a certain type of word, which is that seed for, like, a whole conversation or argument that can start, but, like, in the very... basic, if you just get down to the bottom of it by listening, like, active listening, but, like, truly being present, then, like, you can get to that, like, point and be, you know, be impeccable with your word.
Right. Yeah. I mean, a lot of time is wasted on not important points, you know? Like, how much small talk do you have that, like, with someone that you might genuinely want to connect with, but you don't ever get to that point, you know?
Yeah.
You're just kind of talking about
small
randoms.
Talk.
Yeah,
it's like random, like habits. You know, the first time that I ever took acid, which I don't do much anymore, but the very first time I had a very enlightening experience, at least for me at the time, and I realized that, like, you know, my biggest lesson from that first time was that I'm always at the right place at the right time. That concept of, you know, every single thing in my life has led me to where I am right this moment, and the only this moment can lead me to where I want to go. You know, that kind of whole concept. Like, everything has always led to here, and everything is perfect as it is. It's just like how I decided to go about it. But when I was getting up to that, like coming up, feeling slightly uncomfortable, and I started noticing how, like, my words have speech patterns and habits which feel like clothes. It feels like bulky, uncomfortable clothes. It's like,
interesting.
Also like people that talk about when they peak on acid too, like, they can't really talk. You can't really, like, talk. You can just like express your feelings, but
right.
It's like words are like clothes, you know. That's an interesting concept.
Interesting. Yeah. I mean, that is really interesting. I'm still kind of letting that sink in. I get what you mean. I'm having problem putting into words. I'll have to let it sit a little more. But it is. That's cool. That's a cool concept. And then they are. I mean, I definitely know I have particular speech patterns, like ways that I talk, rhythms, and they elicit a certain response. And if I was to put on different clothes, then I might elicit a different response from people. So absolutely. And I think that's where it comes, again, important to know what clothes you're wearing, you know?
Right. Just awareness. Like, it's not that we have to change anything or try and manipulate anybody. It's not about manipulation. It's about just being, doing the best that you can with the present moment. So, which means that, like, if what you're trying to do is coming from a positive place and you're trying to get this person to feel better, then being conscious enough of the language that I'm using and the body language that I'm using to help them get there. You know, I don't know.
No. How often have you seen two people say the exact same thing to someone, but the way they say it was so different that one person reaches that person and the other person doesn't, even though it was, you know, like almost word for word the same message?
Mm.
Because the body language and that truthful intent behind it, you know, even if the person knows the right words to say, if they're not genuinely interested, that person may not receive it because they feel that they don't really care. You know, they're like, oh yeah, he's saying the words. Sure, he asked me how I'm feeling, but I could tell he, like, looked at his watch and he was, like, kind of looking off into space. So he didn't really want to know how I'm feeling. And then you don't get that genuine answer. They're just, oh, fine, cool, you know.
It's funny you said the two people saying the same exact thing. I've noticed it a lot about myself recently, especially with doing this podcast.
Mm.
I tend to repeat something that somebody else says in my own words. And I don't know whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, or I don't know whether that's what all communication is, you know?
Well, Rustic, that's really funny that you say that, because I think I have a really strong habit of doing that too. And I've been wondering lately whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, because I've always thought of it as a strength. And I've always thought, like you said, that it's just the way people communicate. But I've recently noticed frustration in certain people that I talk to when I do that. And I don't know if that's something that they need to deal with or something that I need to perfect more in my communication style, but I do it to alleviate confusion. You know, I do it to make sure there's clarity. So someone says something to me, and then I repeat that back in my own words so they know that I understood them and so that I know them. You know, if I say something that's different than what they were saying, then hopefully they're going to be honest with me and say, that's not what I said, and we can get to the bottom of it.
Right.
But I don't, like, I sense annoyance with some people, and I don't know what that is. I still haven't figured out which side it's on. I'm probably both sides. But, like, in repeating, sometimes it can, like, frustrate people, or it can feel, I've had people say, like, oh, you're taking my words from me. And I'm like, well, I just repeated what you said. I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not trying to talk over you. I'm trying to give you the space. I just want to make sure we're communicating properly. As I'm speaking, I'm almost starting to think that it could be an insecurity on the other person, because they're, like, afraid of looking stupid, or, you know, like, sometimes people are afraid to admit they're wrong. So maybe it's kind of a form of that.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand it right now as you're talking as well. What if there's basically two modes to a conversation? I don't know if this is true or not. I'm just trying to think of it right now.
We're thinking out loud.
What if there's two modes to conversations? Well, there's probably more. But one of them is, you know, listening, and one of them is communicating, right? So what if, like, what our habits are to repeat what the other person said, that's us just trying to listen better, you know? But maybe some people's conversational styles, they're used to talking to people that only communicate. So they'll communicate something, and the other person doesn't need to repeat it, and they'll communicate something else. You know, maybe that might either mean, like I said, it's either a personal weakness for me because I repeat when some people think I don't need to repeat. But on the other hand, I think it's also a strength because I always preface what I'm about to say to someone with like a little basic, like a couple, like a sentence or so. So then whatever I say, an idea, it gets there.
Context.
But yeah, I think you're right. I think it might be, as long as we're aware of what we're doing and we're just listening consciously, then I think there's nothing to worry about. I think it's just, like you said, like if somebody's insecure that you're repeating something they said, as long as you're not mocking them,
right?
You know, then I think that's just something that the person needs to work on.
I agree. I think that it's probably a little bit of both. I think our desire, and you said worry. I mean, worry and fear are similar. And I think that fear is only ever about things that don't exist. You're afraid of something in the future.
Yeah, it's the future.
That's all fear is. It's about something that doesn't exist yet and may never. Yeah. But to be honest, in the whole vein of being self-exploratory and hopefully learning myself better, I feel like there might be a little bit on both of our parts when talking to anyone, either lack of confidence or fear that they won't understand us. Because if we're to get to that point where we're really being impeccable with our word and we know our message is clear, like you said, you're trying to really think about that, then we won't have to repeat because you'll have that knowledge, that really calm peace. Oh, of course they understood me. And then the other half that's hard for me to accept now is trusting that if the other person doesn't understand, they'll ask the question. And I'm constantly frustrated with people that don't ask enough questions. Now, people have been frustrated with me that I ask too many questions.
Right.
But I'd rather be asking. If you don't ask, you won't receive. Mm-hmm. So if you're not asking questions down the path of where you're going, I don't know how you're going to get there except at an inch pace, slowly stumbling, you know? So I do feel like, as our assurance in our message and our clarity gets better, then there may be less repeating, maybe not. And like, I want to be concise. I love talking and I think it's important, but again, words are, you know, can only get so much and they can get in the way. So I do conceptually believe that someone who's more confident brings more strength when they say, like, you ask me a question, we're having a conversation about anything. You ask me a question, and it's something that I know a lot about. Mm-hmm. Instead of trying to give you all that knowledge in one answer, because I care about you, and you've asked me something that I know and I want to help, instead of trying to distill all that into just one little bubble that I can hand you, it's being less is more. Not that you want to cut someone off or cut them short, but someone else also has to earn the knowledge. Like, if they're not asking the question and you're just trying to give them knowledge that they haven't really asked,
well, they're not ready.
It's not going to sink in. Exactly. Yeah. Cause they're not, yeah, they're
actually, you're saying that is actually like, I'm learning right now because
nice.
I tend to over explain way too many things to people. Like I feel like there's another area of being conscious is I need to work on, I think, is like being understanding of the situation that I'm in and how much time I have to talk to this person. Because sometimes I'll be like doing, you know, background or on set doing stunts or at a bar or something, and I'll be talking to someone and like my friend will ask me a question and I'll be trying to, like, I'll get this answer ready in my head because I'm trying to explain everything, and I'll be like blah 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 blah, and I dump all this on them and they're like, cool. Like,
yeah, you see the wide eyes.
So you're right. There is like situations in which different styles of communication come into play. This is funny. Like this podcast right now is like me trying to figure out how to talk. It's like Gaga.
No, I mean, I know it sounds like we know how to talk. We have much experience in talking, but no, still, even yeah. as I'm sitting here, like, absolutely, like, there's new things developing where my sentence from 5 minutes ago is probably, hopefully, going to be different if I've learned anything from now, because
yeah.
I do feel like these conversations are important, and I don't get to have enough of them, and I want to have more of them,
yeah,
and they are so expanding when you're really actively listening, and you're trying to express what you know, but you're not holding to those things. You're open to, at any second, reversing that if mm-hmm. a new thing comes to light, that they can be really powerful and empowering.
Yeah.
And absolutely, I feel like some things are coming to light now that I really need to put more attention on and examine a little more.
Yeah, me too. Do you have a journal?
Not currently. I've had several journals in my life. I used to love to journal, but right now I'm not. I don't have like a regular. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I'm trying to get into journaling right now. I've had like a Moleskine book for like a couple of years, but it's on and off. I call it a life workbook. The reason I'm asking is because I think there's a balance between free flowing thought and taking steps to get somewhere and using time management.
Absolutely.
And that's what another thing I'm trying to figure out right now. It's like, you know, all we're talking about right now also will apply to the concept of, you know, the optimal self, like being your best version, right? And you hear people talking about this, or you've heard, you know, how the Buddha talked about this. It's just about balance, right? But that's what I'm also trying to figure out. Where is that? Where is that, like, razor blade balance between flowing like crazy and being super, super creative and, like, coming up with everything, and then at the same time being present enough to realize and take action at the same time. You know, it's like that balance. The other day I was driving from Santa Monica. Actually, something that's really helping. There's so many different things to talk about. So,
I know. And we have more. We'll be back.
That's true. But so when I was driving back from Santa Monica with my friend, one of my other friends is a really good friend of mine. We're actually learning longboarding together and slacklining. We just picked up a couple weeks ago.
Cool.
And we were talking on the way back. We're a little bit baked, but we were talking about how I think that the reason we're really good friends is because I tend to be maybe overly chill with things and understanding, and his mind tends to be more overactive, and he's not as present. So he started meditating recently after we started hanging out, and when he meditates, he focuses on just like calming his mind completely. When I meditate, I'm trying to take my calm mind and I'm trying to give it like a razor sharp focus to give it some drive, you know? So it's interesting how like, but like we're all both trying to get to the same place. So that's right. An interesting concept, like balance, you know, between like those two extremes. And I'm trying to learn from this person and he's trying to learn from me. It's very interesting. Like,
it is. That's one of my favorite things, when two people from opposite places and like maybe like not opposite but very different thought patterns are going towards the same thing, because mm-hmm. even though you might think they're opposite, even though you'd hear them talk
yeah.
and at first glance you're like, oh, they're nothing similar, there's such an underlying similarity that when your paths are parallel but completely different, that's like you can learn the most from each other, because
mm-hmm.
you've witnessed each other from the outside. You've hit a lot of the same decisions but made different choices at those decisions, so you can compare
right.
and be like, you know, when I was more talkative in this situation, this happened, versus, oh, well, when I was quiet, I learned way more because,
yeah.
you know, I was listening.
Yeah.
It's funny because I think that I tend to be more, when I meditate, I'm trying to quiet my brain.
Mm-hmm.
I'm absolutely just trying to, like, not nothing, but like silence all the thoughts that I feel come from my physical brain about survival or eating or
mm-hmm.
whatever, insecurities, versus the like highest, the your best self, your optimal self, your like, what things can I do today?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what there's when I used to work with Jeff Olin, we used to have this thing, and it's been a couple of years, but there was a chart that we had, and there's four quadrants in the chart. Mm-hmm. And each quadrant of them talks about different types of work you can do. And there's overlap because each one is more like a column. It's, you know, right. It's on both sides of the graph. But there's the four quadrants are urgent but not important, urgent and important, not urgent but important, and not urgent, not important. Mm-hmm. Every type of work falls into one of those four categories. Mm-hmm. And so to give you an example, and I'm mixing up the quadrant numbers, but this is a known concept. If you go on Google, you can Google this. It's, you know, I'm not making this up. It's not my own idea. So in the quadrant that is urgent but not important, your urgent thing may be laundry because you're running out of underwear and you need to do laundry now or you're not going to have any underwear to wear. Right. But the important thing may be calling back your boss or an agent that returned your call.
Right.
And the hardest thing is for people to focus on the things that are important and not urgent. Because when they're urgent, they have a timed deadline. But the important things that aren't urgent are usually the things that make the biggest difference. Those are the clearing your mind and doing your optimal self. You're not just cooking, even though cooking is important, yeah. Laundry is important.
That's the stuff that you're investing in now that doesn't have an effect until the future. It's kind of like doing an assignment. Like, you know, I used to cram it in the last 2 hours before it was due.
Yeah,
but then, like, and then every time I did it, it'd be like, man, why don't I just do this, like, at the beginning whenever I didn't have to be urgent?
Yeah, but because it's not. We're not thinking about it. It's not like pressing. We know about it.
The busy trap?
The busy trap.
Like, the concept of the busy trap is, like...
Maybe.
Like...
I don't know.
We tend to... Especially because, you know, only in the last several hundred years did we become more sedentary and we have less, like, actual physical things to go do. Like, our bodies feel like we should be physically doing something all the time, which... means that, like, we'll fill up our time with urgent, not important things. You know, sometimes they're urgent and important, sometimes they're urgent, not important, but, like, we're only filling our time up with, like, things that are urgent now, and that's called the busy trap. Tim Ferriss talks about it on his blog. It's a really good blog post. And it's like you said, the thing is, like, to be successful, you know, I think building a business or even in the film industry, everything is doing stuff that is in the not urgent but important category that is going to be investing in yourself for the future.
Exactly. They're easy to do and easy not to do, even though you know they're important.
They're just those little things. You know they're important. You know it's important to drink more water, but it's not urgent. And you're like, I'm not going to die for 3 days if I don't drink water.
And I'm feeling good now. What? I don't need any more water. I'm not, you know. But, like, yeah, that slight edge over time. Like, if you don't drink water, your body's not going to be happy. You're going to be less healthy. Like, and that's just one tiny example of something that everyone knows they should do more of. Like, how many people drink enough water in this country? No one.
Yeah. Well, like,
Nice.
We try.
Nice. Yeah, I'm getting better. I listen to a lot of Louise Hay. You know Louise Hay?
No.
She's really great. She's a positive spiritual woman. She owns Hay House Publishing.
Louise Hay, is it a podcast?
I don't think she does podcasts. She might do podcasts. There's a lot of, she's written a couple books.
Okay.
And there's a lot of stuff on YouTube and online that you can listen to.
Louise Hay.
Louise Hay. She's awesome.
Write this down.
And she actually had cancer and overcame it that she attributes to complete just mindset. Mm-hmm. She talks about spiritually that her cancer was discovered and diagnosed at the exact right time in her life for her to heal properly, and she did. She got completely healed, went into remission, and she's like 75 years old now, and she's just started taking up dancing. She's like healthier than she's ever been. And, you know, the reason I brought her up just now was one of the things she always says is, in terms of affirmations, she does a lot of great affirmation stuff. Water is my favorite drink. And so
that's awesome.
I love a lot of other things to drink. I'm actually a person that prefers drinking over eating. If I have a choice of two activities, I would like to drink liquids rather than eat solids.
I prefer eating sweets to anything.
Really? Yeah, well...
That's my problem.
Yeah. But, if you're drinking plenty of water, it's not bad.
That's true.
So, you know, I used to eat a lot of candy. I don't eat as much candy anymore, but I definitely have been using that one affirmation. Like, there's
water
a joke.
Water is my favorite drink.
Water is my favorite drink. I say that all the time. Nicole and I laugh at each other. We'll look at each other, and we'll just say it, and we'll know, you know, like... And I feel like... Not just am I drinking more water, but I enjoy the water that I drink more, strangely. Yeah. I'm like, oh, this is really refreshing.
It's so interesting that you brought up the concept of affirmations, because just today I was talking to my friend that I told you about, the one that's having a hard time, and I was like, have you ever heard of affirmations? And he was like, no, what's that? I'm like, okay, well, do you have an internal dialogue going on ever? And he was like, well, I don't know. What do you mean? How do you think? Do you think in words or do you think in thoughts? So it's interesting that, like, well, sorry, this is like a little tangent, and it's interesting how some people aren't really aware of how they think yet, or they're not really aware of the positive or negative stuff that they tell themselves yet. But the positive affirmations, I haven't been using them as much lately, but like one of the things that turned my life into, you know, to where I am now, which I think is, I'm in a really good place, you know, mentally and physically and everything, but it was a book I was reading called The Trick to Money is Having Some. And on the surface, it sounds like, you know, oh, it's a money book, whatever. But it's very, very metaphysical. And one of the things in the book that I got from it was these three affirmations that were, like, really useful to me. And I actually recently shared it with my friend who I'm learning longboarding with. His name is Zach. And once I started using them, you know, I've always heard about them. And I was like, yeah, sure, I'll say something to myself, or I'll write something on a piece of paper and whatever. Like, maybe it'll work, maybe it didn't. But when I made myself say these things to myself for like a week, 2 weeks, it completely like changed my outlook on the world. It's crazy. Like literally my world transformed into different colors and shit. Like I think I started seeing more colors. Wow. And these affirmations were like simple. And just three things. And it was, I'm always in the right place at the right time, which was, like I said, on my acid trip, that was my biggest realization. I was like, I'm always in the right place at the right time. Mm. Always. Like, you know, every single thing that's led you here, everything happened for a reason. However you want to look at it, you're always in the right place at the right time, because that always gives you like the present moment.
That's right.
You know, then abundance is simple and natural to me. Abundance in terms of, you can think of it money, you could think of it love, you could think of it friendships, but abundance in general, like the love, the feeling comes from that abundance, just is simple. First of all, it's simple and natural to me. So it just naturally comes. As soon as we get rid of all this extra stuff, it's natural, right? And then the third one is my needs are constantly met. Which means if you're alive right now, your needs have always been met, because you would be dead by now, right? Your needs are constantly met.
Right.
If you think back, like I think back to my life, times when I had stressful times, you know, monetarily, whatever, no matter what, even when I was like in the dumps, I was like, I wasn't literally dumps, but basically I was almost homeless because I was late on rent, and something always came through. Your needs are constantly met, right? I think the trick is to making your needs not be so dire, but
right.
But those three affirmations have helped me a lot. And what helped me too is think about them, but then really like feel that feeling, and then feel those feelings throughout the day, like a couple times a day. Like, you know, I'm always in the right place at the right time, so that's just like a very grounding, like good feeling. Abundance is simple and natural to me. That's just like that growing, like connected feeling. And my needs are constantly met, so there's like no fear, you know. So having those three was like a little tool that helped me a lot. And I started saying it recently because of my conversations I've been having, and it's actually, again, like, changing it. And a thing about affirmations is, isn't it similar to reality checks? Like, have you ever heard of lucid dreaming? Like,
yeah, I freaking love lucid dreaming. Yeah, I've done some crazy lucid dreaming.
Really? I haven't done it since I was, like, little, because I had lucid nightmare once, and I stopped.
Oh, shit.
But one of the tricks to lucid dreaming that people talk about is doing reality checks throughout the day, right? It's like, throughout the day, when you remember, do a reality check, like an Inception or like the movie Inception, or like in reality, people like look at their watch or something, and they really study it to really make sure they're present and are they awake or in a dream right now, right? So that, like, that I feel like relates very closely to positive affirmations, because you're taking stock of exactly where you are, you're grounding yourself very present, and then you're also adding something positive to that, you know. It's like,
Interesting. Yeah, that is. I like that. I didn't really like ever make that connection of the parallels between those two, about lucid dreaming versus if you use those same kind of techniques and tools in your real life.
Just be more awake now.
Right. Yeah, that's really cool. I mean, yeah, that's really cool. I have always been tripped out by the power of lucid dreaming, because I know that mentally, our brains don't know the difference between what we see in our mind's eye and what we see through our eyes. Like, you've all heard that if you've seen the movie What the Bleep Do We Know?
No, I haven't seen the movie.
Oh my God, dude, you should come over and watch it. It's really friggin' amazing. There was a time in my life where I was buying copies and then just giving them away like once a month.
Really?
Because I was like that into like, people need to know this stuff.
I think I've seen it on Netflix or something. What the Bleep Do We Know Anyway?
What the Bleep Do We Know is just what the title is. And it's a hybrid documentary from 2007, so it's a little older now, but it did win Best Documentary of the Year back then.
Mm-hmm.
And what they examine is, they examine neuroscience and quantum physics, and there can be some debate about this, but when you look at a brain under an MRI, mm-hmm. it looks the same whether you're seeing the thing or whether you're picturing the thing.
Mm-hmm.
This is why, like, when people have heard the phenomenon, there was an example a bunch of years ago where two basketball teams, same skill level, same, I think, even coach. They were like, it was very controlled. One team spent 30 minutes a day taking shots, and the other team spent 30 minutes a day picturing themselves making shots.
Mm-hmm.
And the team that did the visualizing was actually better at the end of 90 days than the team that did the physical practicing of the thing. And so when you talk about that, like, I still always struggle to see how our brains deal with dreams and, like, how, you know, like, they are so powerful. Like, I mean, I used to have lucid dreams, of course, like flying. I used to have lucid dreams where, like, you would know you're dreaming and you can just kind of command stuff. And I do feel like that's a representation of the of the world, you know? But I don't, I don't see that cross point yet.
When you were just talking, I had the thought of, not the thought, but the observation that, like, first of all, visualization is a very concrete and useful tool that can be used to just, like, achieve just about anything. But then also when you're saying that your mind can't tell the difference between what's in your mind's eye and what's in reality. See, I would say that I agree with that to an extent, but not completely, because by doing reality checks, you're proving that you can check whether you're in reality or not and you're dreaming, right? So
right.
So then by doing reality checks, you can ground yourself and really be present, right? So that's the little, like way you can squeeze past and make sure, like, you're doing that, right? But I think both are useful. Like, it's very useful to be extremely present, extremely grounded. And it's also very useful to know how to use visualizations to do stuff. And my visualization powers aren't as strong as I wish they were, because I hear people talk about, like, when I'm trying to learn parkour moves and stuff like that, people talked about it before, where they will, I know friends that have gotten a lot of moves down and learned really quickly without injuries because they would sit there and they would actually visualize themselves going through the move. They would start lucid dreaming on purpose and then go trick in their dreams, martial arts tricking.
Wow.
And then they would go and do it for real. The only time that's ever happened to me was when I was younger. I was like 14 or 15, and I had a lucid dream one time. And at the time, I was working on getting my splits, my front splits, and I just couldn't get them. And in my dream, I did them, and I was like, this is how it feels. And then in reality, whenever I eventually did it, it felt the exact same way. So it's so interesting that also whatever you do in your dreams is so connected to your physical body.
But you said something very important, not just in what you were just saying, but a few minutes ago, when you were talking about those three affirmations that you're doing now.
Mm-hmm.
You're not just saying the words and visualizing it. You're thinking about how you would feel. You're taking those feelings with you.
Yeah.
And that's something that I know is important and still need to incorporate more. I know intellectually, but I don't know that I'm integrating it, is... It's not even so much the visualization, although that is a huge part of it. I think a bigger part of it is that feeling. Like, yes, you saw yourself doing the thing, but you said something very important. Mm-hmm. You said, this is what it feels like to do that?
Yeah.
It's that, because that feeling is so much stronger, you know? Like,
yeah.
We have thoughts, and that's our neurons firing, but the emotions in our brain... Mm-hmm. are crazy
emotions
powerful.
In your body.
Our entire body, that's right. Yeah, I think of the brain because I know it's being manufactured in the hippocampus, you know, but, like, it does, it transfers throughout our entire body. There's, you know, messages being sent everywhere. It's not just up there. I just think about that as, like, the point of origination.
That's true. I wanted to write really quickly, add on before you said that. One of the things I learned at the Vipassana retreat is what people tend to think of the subconscious mind, the unconscious mind, is literally your body. That's a concept that I learned there. That I've been, I've, you know, I'm still maybe 75% sure of that, but I'm 75% sure of that because, you know, when you're doing Vipassana retreat and you're doing body scanning meditation, eventually you'll feel like a knot in a muscle, and you just feel it relax, and all of a sudden like a vivid memory just goes in your head. You know, it's like,
that's incredible.
Yeah, and that's what we're talking about, like meditation and being able to bring yourself to your present moment, into your breath, into how you're feeling inside of your body throughout the day, is like you're the ultimate tool of reference. That's what the teacher at the Vipassana retreat is. Just it's like they give you a tool for your toolbox to go through life, and that tool is you're able to really like be so in touch with your body through the meditation that you do, that whenever you're having a conversation with someone, you're literally feeling where inside your body that conversation is and how it's making you feel. So you're literally, whoa, like, you know, the concepts, the very basic, here, I'll put a link to that video I put up. I'll send it to you as well about my retreat experience. But
okay,
the whole concept behind it is whenever you react to something, when you do something, it's not that somebody said, okay, for example, somebody says something mean to you, you yell at them, or somebody on the road, you know, driving, cuts you off, and you start yelling and cussing, whatever. You're not doing that because, oh, that person cut you off. You're doing that because, first of all, you see that happen, then that creates, it goes right into your brain, and your past memories are like consolidated, and your brain realizes, okay, what's happened in the past? Like, how did I feel in the past? And then that creates a literal physical sensation, like an actual physical sensation on your body, to which then you react. You react to the physical sensation in your body. So think about this. If you're angry at something or someone, you don't just like say something mean. First, you're going to feel something, and then you're just like, it builds up. And then all of a sudden, like, you'll have to, it just comes out of you. You have to say something, right? If that keeps building up, it comes into a physical thing, you know? First it goes thoughts, then speech, then actions, you know? It's just, and it's, the Vipassana, why it's such a good tool, is it teaches you to stop blindly reacting to things. So it teaches you to be able to observe your body, and something comes and you watch it, and you just watch it happen and change. You could choose whether to get carried away by it or whether to then like make a decision on what the present moment is. And Vipassana is also called wisdom cultivation meditation, because that's what wisdom comes from itself, is just being like super present and like not reacting. And you know, that's an interesting concept as well. Just wanted to share that.
It is. That's a very interesting concept. Thank you for sharing that with me. I mean, that totally, like, it's so funny how, like you say, there's often times where one of us will say something and it makes me want to bring up so many different points. And I do love the interconnectivity of life like that, because as we're talking, I'm so curious about life that I hear these things and I want to learn more about this, so I want to bring this up. But about what you were just saying that I think is very interesting is, I do, first of all, think all that's true, the physical body and everything. So it's not the first time I've heard it, but in relation why it's so fresh in my mind is my friend that's kind of struggling and used to be very spiritual, but is not necessarily in the place he was. I was bringing up Eckhart Tolle to him when he was trying to have me get mad with him. Mm-hmm. And he kind of had this attitude that wasn't the first time I've heard it, where people think, oh, well, you're enlightened, so you're going to be boring. You're going to just be unaffected and calm and still the whole time. Mm-hmm. And you're not going to be human. You're not going to have these human reactions. I don't think that's what it's about. Yes, of course, we don't want to be driven by our reaction, by our external circumstances, but it's about having control over that. Mm-hmm. If we do Vipassana, say, and we gain control over, I'm aware of my body, I'm aware that this is eliciting this response, we can still choose to have whatever response we want, and I think that's okay. It's a boring life to suddenly become enlightened, and then nothing bothers you, and there's nothing exciting. But when you're choosing very directly, you're like, this happened, and I want to have a happy experience because of it. Sure, I want to go crazy. I want to yell and express all these emotions. That's what enlightenment is about. It's about doing what's going to make you happy. It's not about being so calm and peaceful that nothing affects you, and you're this like flatline human being.
It's so funny that you bring that up. That was like one of the main reasons. I never actually did the full 10-day retreat. I did 6 days, and I came back early, and I'm still planning on doing the whole thing. One of the reasons I came back was a reaction I was having to that exact same concept. If I'm going to make myself not react to anything, I'm just going to be a zombie. But then by the time I got home, I realized that, like, I was ready to go back, first of all. And secondly, I had, later on that year, like, this was last year, I went to a music festival, a transformational festival called Lightning in a Bottle. What I realized was the other side of that concept of, like, I'm going to be a zombie. No, it's like, not being afraid of it and going through it. And we realized then that, like, what we were talking about earlier, when you're at that base level, just, some people call it grace, people call it different things, but those random spurts of happiness and love come out of you, and that's the true you from the inside that comes out. And then you're able to really happily live your life and be, you know, our egos and our memories want to hang on to this idea that we think we are this person, and what's going to happen if I get rid of all, like, my blind reactions to stuff, then I'm not going to be a person. But what happened, what I went through, and it's a tough thing to go through. They actually call it the dark night of the soul. There's actually a term for it, because when I got back from the retreat, I was depressed for like two. The first day I felt fine. The next 2 days I was depressed. I was like, what is the point of all this? If this is all it is, then what's the point? And I started Googling stuff. I started looking it up. I'm like, what's happening? And I found it's called the dark night of the soul. When people are gaining wisdom, and you can't go backwards.
Right.
You can regress a little bit, but you can never, once you've seen something, you can't just ever, like, to truly forget it. So you have to go through. And you're going through a dark night of the soul, but on the other side, and you just realize that it's just, yeah, it is all it is. So you might as well enjoy the ride, because you can now choose to consciously do everything that you wanted to ever do, but you're not, like, caught up by it. It's just like, there's a comedian, Bill Hicks, and he did a little stand-up piece, and he's just like, life is a roller coaster, you know? I don't know if you remember his actual quote.
I know Bill Hicks. I don't remember. I don't know this quote.
There was, like, a quote, and he was talking about how, like, you know, life is like a roller coaster, and you're strapped in. And you might as well just enjoy the ride, right? So that's just, like, the other half of it. It's like, it's not holding on to your past, like, reactive habits, and just, like, once you have that mindset understanding of, like, once you have that presence cultivating, you're cultivating presence, then you can actually choose to be happy. Like, when I go back from the retreat, I just, like, started, like, playing guitar with much more vigor. I just saw, like, these lights outside of my apartment that were, like, dirty, and I was like, why wouldn't somebody clean them? That's what I was thinking before I got back there from the retreat. When I got back, I was like, oh, I have 20 minutes. I went out there with a Windex, and I cleaned everything, and I felt great about it.
Wow.
It's like, you're doing these things, you know? And ever since then, even right now when I'm talking to you, I'm actually, like, rolling. Like, I feel serotonin releasing my brain right now. Like, you get chills, you know?
Totally.
So, once again, MDMA experiences have taught me what rolling feels like. Rolling is a term whenever you're having massive releases of serotonin, and you're having, like, small enlightening experiences. Ever since I went to the retreat, when I have a conversation with someone that's deep, I've started feeling the chills going through my body. And this is a complete segue, but this is another thing. It's literally like letting me just enjoy myself. I'm figuring out how to naturally be rolling all the time.
Right. And in a way that is, I mean, I feel like that feeling is so tied to abundance. And
yeah.
I mean, we've covered that internal abundance will reflect external abundance. That's my goal. My goal in life is to be naturally, just through my brain and my spirituality and my joy, be rolling all the time and be having these mini epiphanies of, oh my gosh, wow, I didn't know that before.
It's called high on life. It's the same term.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's crazy.
I don't have to go, but didn't you say you have to pick up a friend at 6?
Yeah. Yeah, let's just wrap it up.
I didn't know. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm freaking love this. We could keep going forever. And we'll definitely come back and do more for you guys. Not because we're getting anything out of it.
The truth is, I'm really glad we just turned the microphone on, because we started talking, and there's too many times where we're having conversations with people, and after like an hour, I'm just like, man, why didn't we record that?
Right.
Because if you think about it, or part of me thinks that, like, well, am I ever going to have that same conversation with that person again, because we've already went through it, you know?
Right.
So I'm really glad that we just recorded.
I'm really glad we recorded too.
Yep.
Here's the funny thing, that to make it full circle, you to tie in something you said a second ago. There's no going back. You can never go backwards. Yes, sometimes you have regression. But once you hear something, you can't unhear it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's an interesting phenomenon that I've noticed that happens with me that I used to fault myself for this, where I would hear something. I've said it already. I know something conceptually and I haven't integrated it, which to me doesn't say that I've unlearned it or I'm going backwards, but I haven't moved as forward as I want. And so I do think that when you were kind of saying sometimes there's a little bit of regression, I still feel like there's no direct regression of going back,
right.
But you revisit, there's cycles, right?
Yeah.
And you revisit concepts that you need to again. Like if you're someone who is, like your curiosity and your thirst is to get deep and to understand it. And when you heard that conversation, or when you had or heard that conversation the first time, you only had enough time or even enough knowledge at that point to get to a certain level. Mm-hmm. That you may revisit that just out of need to understand it better and deeper and to go further down the path, not because you didn't understand it
right.
for what it was before. So I do think that although we've had hit a lot of great topics and had many insights from me that I'm going to be going home thinking about, holy crap, that's yeah, I need to sit with that more and do some journaling about it. Whatever we're meant to come back to, I know that at least half a dozen of the things we've talked about, we will keep discussing and get deeper into and have new insights and revelations in a quest to know ourselves and to, you know, get, I mean, as deep as I think, I'm on a quest to get as deep and real as I can possibly get in this physical body. Because I know that everything will be answered when I'm done.
Yeah.
But then you're done. You return to source. So you know everything and you have all the answers.
Right.
So while we're here, I feel like we're supposed to do as much as we can in this physical world in terms of having those epiphanies, spreading love and joy and being creative and just like radiating that love and that being.
Adding value, you know, like it's just
there
like,
it is again.
Yeah. And it totally goes into like the business world too. Like Tony Robbins talks about how literally if you just find out how to add the most value in whatever you're doing, then no matter what, you're going to be successful. And I love what you just said about how we're going to revisit it if we have to, if we need to, because, and that there's nothing to worry about, because that's the concept that we're talking about earlier, that there's nothing to worry about, really. That was just literally no fear, like, nothing to hold on to, no clinging, just like, we had an amazing conversation, and if it's meant to be again, just like that concept of I'm always in the right place at the right time, it all ties together. It's all different ways to say the same little concept. You know, all these little truths are all part of like the one bigger one.
Yeah, there is one truth that unites everything, and that is like,
I think it's a feeling.
It is. I don't think it can. That's it. I'm so glad you said that, because my mind was combing over all the words I know that even come close to it, and none of them were doing it, because you can't. It's just
it's about feeling it, figuring out how to feel it, and then helping others feel it. That's it.
Yeah, that's it. It's that simple. It's that easy.
Yeah. If we and let doing. It be. And doing, exactly.
Right.
And like you said, like action, you know, knowledge and action. But that's why feeling is different than knowledge. It's feeling, it's physical, like feeling, and that builds on itself. If you're actually doing a lot of things and you're building your lifestyle to a certain way, you're all of a sudden you're motivated. You have this like feeling that's actually growing even more, you know? Yeah.
And it snowballs and it takes on a life of its own and it becomes, you know, this energy that does possess, I don't want to say it possesses being, but it possesses like space in this physical world. You know, it's almost palpable.
Yeah,
like you could almost touch it. But
yeah, it manifests itself.
Yeah, exactly.
Now we sound like hippies.
I know.
I do want to go to Burning Man,
dude. I know. Nicole and I really want to go. We tried to get tickets last year and we couldn't. We were trying to go this year. We went to Lightning in a Bottle a bunch of years ago.
You did?
Yeah.
You guys should go again.
I know.
Go on this year. There's still tickets on sale.
Absolutely.
There's also Symbiosis in the fall that I want to go to, but it's like the same thing, but it's in the fall.
And isn't it, I think I've heard of Symbiosis, isn't it in like the woods? Is Northern California the woods? Oh.
Yeah. I would love to go to that.
That's awesome. When we went to LIB, it was not where it is now. It was at a different location. It was on a lake. Mm-hmm. There was like a small mountain and a lake, and there was campgrounds on both sides of the mountain, and there was stages at the top of the hill, but there was also stages at the bottom, and it was really cool, but it still didn't feel like heavy wilderness.
Yeah.
Like, I would love to do something that's in the forest, or something that's really surrounded by nature.
Yeah. Dude, I love transformational festivals. Like, the concept that I found it, you know, like, I went to Coachella in 2012, but, like, there's a difference between, like, a party festival and, like, a festival where you can still go party, but you can go and you can learn about yourself and you could get creative. You can get creational inspiration, motivation, productivity. There's business talks. There's a healthy eating lifestyle workshops. There's all this. There's a meditation lookout. There's world-renowned like yoga teachers there every day, 24, like I'm not 24/7, but on all the hours of the day. You can get the full experience, and it's a transformational festival. You know, that's why people refer to Burning Man and Lightning in a Bottle, a place like this, like their home. It's like they go home once a year. You know, it's like when I was there, I literally felt that I was like, wow. And there was something about being around like those high energy people, just literally physically being around high energy people, made me physically feel amazing after. Like for 3 weeks afterwards, I had an afterglow. It was literally, I just felt like I was charged. I felt like I was sober, and I felt like I was in the acid of life. Like that's how I describe it ever since. Like it's crazy.
That's funny. That's cool. I mean, yeah, dude, that's amazing. That's how I feel when I leave too. I can only imagine how Burning Man is.
Yeah.
Like Burning Man, you can go. It is 24 hours a day. They have like you know financial speakers at 3 a.m. and like, you know, it's crazy. Like absolutely, when you're on, I mean, the saying, what is it? Water rises to meet itself. Like, if you're around all those people, it's all vibrational energy. You're all lifting each other up. And I also personally believe that, like, there's this weird phenomenon where souls are bigger. I don't think souls fit in our bodies. Mm-hmm. If they inhabit any physical space, which is debatable, this is why I explain, personally, and again, this is just my opinion, but this is why I explain, like, have you ever had that feeling when you're driving out of L.A. or a big city? There's this point that you reach beyond the border where all of a sudden you can like breathe deeper.
Yeah.
I've always personally explained that as soul overlap. Mm-hmm. So like you're in the city right now. There's people living everywhere. We're super, you know, there's an apartment right through this wall. And mm-hmm. So that's why people affect each other manifestively, like energetically, because our souls are much bigger than our bodies. So there's a lot of soul overlap. Mm-hmm. And so... But everyone's thinking different things in the city. Everyone's thinking, I got to get to this job, I got to do this, I'm late, I'm behind, I got to do this. When we're all at that one place and we're all there for that same self-elevational goal, that transformational element, it is that like group meditation power where...
Exponential, like, it's the energy just goes higher and higher.
1 + 1 equals more than 2.
Yeah.
It's bigger than the sum of its parts. It's so powerful. That, yeah, like, crazy things can be done. And to go off on another tangent, I used to study art history. And one of the things one of the most powerful things that stuck with me with art history was when we study, like, really ancient cultures, like Native Americans and, you know, like not primitive, but, like, nowhere near Western culture. They all would like Egyptian type of cultures. They've a lot of these ancient types of cultures, almost all of them had entire cities that were uninhabited, that were built for once a year, several times a year, families, mothers and children going together to take a hallucinogenic substance and have this spiritual awakening. It was a part of life.
Yeah.
It was just what they did. And it correlated with the seasons. It correlated with the coming of, you know, spring and summer and all this. So to me, like when we talk about people that are so uptight and frustrated, yeah, granted, not everyone should trip acid. Not everyone should smoke even weed.
Yeah.
Things are different for everyone. But it's so ingrained in us that's one reason why it's so powerful. Right. And I would even give it as a prescription to some people. Like, hey, get out of your life for a second.
Yeah.
Go to this festival and just see what happens.
Or go to the wild somewhere. You know, some people also like have very bad experiences on like psychedelics, but it's usually if they're in a bad place. People talk about set and setting, your mindset and the setting that you're in, you know, like going in nature and connecting with it and having like a divine experience, you know. Have you heard of the Greek mysteries? That's, you know, the ancient Greeks used to have once a year or several times a year, they made this drink from, I think it was a blue lotus flower, and it's also hallucinogenic, and it's called the Greek Mysteries or the Mysteries of Ulysses or something like that. And same thing happened before the Romans came in and like, were like, pagans, whatever, get rid of it. But they were also had psychedelic traditions throughout them.
That's cool.
Interesting concept that Alex Gray was talking about in the podcast I was listening to yesterday, the Joe Rogan podcast. And he said that he thinks of humans as... he thinks like the Earth is kind of getting its own... there's already different multiple huge intelligences. For example, if you talk about... There's like a forest in the Pacific Northwest, which is like the largest mycelium network in the world. So it's just like one collective consciousness of plants where if something happens, like if animals eat a tree, the certain type of tree, downwind, then the trees... downwind from that can feel, or something's released where they can smell it, and then they become bitter, so those animals don't come eat them. So they're like super like,
whoa,
like an intelligence, right? And this, yeah. And Alex Gray was saying how he thinks that that's what's happening with humans now too. We're more like a mushroom than anything else. We're the only animal that's more like a mushroom than anything else, like the way our brains or networks are connected. So, and he was saying, they were talking about bringing up the concept of how now that there's these transformational festivals popping up, it's like little places where we can go and elevate ourselves, you know. And it kind of goes back to the theory that some people believe is that the reason we developed our brains so much is because ancient people found mushrooms, psychedelic mushrooms. That's another very strong theory that goes through.
Oh wow!
As we elevate it, and kind of if you think about like 2001: A Space Odyssey.
Okay.
You seen
yeah.
It? Like,
yeah.
I read this really good article about how they compared that obelisk to like a mushroom. Actually, no, it was a talk at Lightning in a Bottle. Actually.
Oh.
And how it's like a monument that appears through different parts throughout history to help us like take the next step or get through somewhere, you know. So he was comparing that obelisk, how like psychedelic mushrooms are to us, because they've been with us since the beginning. They really have. That's why they exist right now, is because they've gone through the whole evolutionary process.
Right. Yeah, they've been here probably longer than we have.
Yeah.
That's cool. I've not heard that comparison, and I freaking love that movie. I've heard countless different theories.
Have you seen it?
Oh yeah. Okay. Oh, I freaking love it. We studied that film in school.
Nice.
Like there was, because of the bajillion things that I studied in my 7-year undergraduate education.
Yeah. It was the first time I saw that movie, is like just recently.
Oh, nice. Okay, yeah. Crazy, right? Deep.
Yeah.
Weird. I would believe that. I could totally get on board that the obelisk is a metaphor for mushrooms. Mushrooms, of course, being my favorite illicit substance on this planet.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I was talking about mushrooms is some people tend to do them all at once, which I've done like once or twice. But my favorite is to actually do them in little tiny bits throughout like a day, or like when you hang out with friends or at night. It's like it just feels like one long like carnival.
Interesting. You mean like you'll get like an eighth and then just take like one cap or something, or?
Yeah, take like an eighth throughout the whole time that you're doing it, right? Versus all at once.
Yeah, interesting. I've never done that.
It feels like you're rolling.
Right. Well, I mean, psilocybin and MDMA are chemically very similar.
Are they?
Nice. Yeah, that's like, you know, and of course, psilocybin being the main ingredient in mushrooms, for those that don't know, and MDMA being the pure version of ecstasy, just the molly that's in ecstasy. I'm a big fan of drugs, but I will never take something that I haven't researched first. One of my buddies was really into pharmacology, and I forget the book now, but there was this book that this guy wrote in like the 70s or 80s where he literally tried like 5,000 drugs, and he invented like 4,000 of them. They've never been around, and he literally in a lab was like, let's make this derivative of acid and see what happens to me.
What?
And just tried it on himself. Yeah.
That's crazy.
And he journaled everything, like very scientifically.
Wow.
It's friggin' cool.
There's a book?
It's a book. I can get the name of it. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure we could find it with a Google search, but yeah.
What's it about?
If you Google, let's see. I'm going to be shooting in the dark here, but Google like scientist that invents drugs and tries them on himself book or something.
In what year?
It was the 70s or the 80s. I think it was the 70s. Because it was the time, you know, when like Quaaludes and all those things were around. They weren't like...
Was it Alexander Shulgin?
It might be. I think it is, yeah. I think it is Alexander Shulgin. Yeah, there's a lot
There's a lot of books. That's super interesting. It might be Alexander Shulgin. I'll find out.
Yeah, we'll have to do some more research.
Yeah. Anyways, let's wrap this up.
Yeah, let's do it. Cool. That sounds good.
So
this is awesome.
Yeah, dude, thank you so much for coming and hanging out.
Thanks for having me, man.
Yeah
we need to do this more often. There'll definitely be more.
I hope so. And then, so let's just recap really quick. What is something that you got that's the most useful out of this, do you think?
For me, I think the things that are going to be the most heavy I'm going to be thinking about when I go home are, there's many things I even almost want to listen to the tape and hear again, but very specifically, your three mantras,
the three affirmations.
The three affirmations are really simple.
I'm always in the right place at the right time. Abundance is simple, natural to me, and my needs are constantly met. Cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's just think about that and let's end on that one.
Like, what did you get out of this today?
What did I get out of this? Let me see my notes.
Oh yeah, all right.
I was taking some notes. Honestly, I also got an affirmation out of it. Like, water's my favorite drink.
Nice. That's awesome.
So that's the thing that I'm going to take. It's, you know, I think it's, there's so much. I'm going to listen to this again and take notes. But the one that I'm taking with me is, you know, simple.
I like it.
I like that we're keeping it simple. Like, just simple affirmation. Water's my favorite drink. And those other three, which is most in the right place at the right time. Abundance is simple, natural to me, and my needs are constantly met. And when I memorize them, I actually just memorize three words: time, abundance, and needs. So it's like, so then you could just like remember those.
Right. Time, abundance, and needs. I'm always in the right place at the right time. Abundance is simple. That's what it is.
And natural.
Abundance is simple and natural, and my needs are always met.
Yeah.
Nice.
Nice.
That's awesome. And you know, I was going to share this earlier. I'll share it now just as we're closing. Anthony Robbins, he doesn't even call them affirmations anymore. He used to back in the day, but because that word's been so overused, he calls them incantations now. Incantations. Like a spell.
Yeah.
Like you are commanding your body in the universe to give you what you want. And I don't mean that in a selfish way. I mean the universe wants you to have what you want. Yeah. We're here to have our highest manifestations realized.
Yeah, just every religion probably says this, but I know Christianity says, ask and you shall receive.
But it's true.
Yeah, it's true.
It's true. Yeah. So I'm going to ask you to, let's do this again soon. We're 15 minutes away. We're real close.
Cool.
And thank you.
Dude, thank you so much.
Oh, yeah.
And thank you guys for listening to our second episode of our podcast. I will leave the links to whatever we talked about in the episode in the description. Also, if you have any questions or comments for us, you can comment here on the video page or on our Facebook page at facebook.com/theoptimalself. Any and all feedback is appreciated. This is our second episode. I'm committing to making 5 of these and then deciding then whether to continue or not. So if you have any suggestions for a future episode or any feedback, let me know. I hope you guys all have a beautiful day and talk to you next time.